Hi students, in the previous topic we had discussed about the interface. Now we are going to look at asynchronous data transfer. What is this asynchronous data transfer? As you can see, data transfer takes place between two entities, source unit and destination unit. Now if both the source unit and destination units are using same clock signal, then both are called synchronized. Okay, and the data transfer is called synchronized data transfer. If both the units are not synchronized, then the data transfer between them is called asynchronous data transfer. Now this asynchronous data transfer can be executed in different ways. One way is strobe controlled asynchronous data transfer. Another one is handshake controlled asynchronous data transfer. Let us look at strobe controlled asynchronous data transfer. What is this strobe? Strobe is the control signal required to establish the synchronization between source unit and destination unit. Originally, clock signal is used as the source unit and destination unit are not sharing the same clock. This strobe control signal is used for that purpose. Okay. Now this strobe controlled data transfer can be classified into two ways: source initiated or destination initiated. That means this data transfer can be initiated either by source or the destination. Okay, if it is initiated by the source, then source will place the data on the data bus, valid data on the data bus, and then make this strobe signal high. It will change the strobe signal from low to high. Whereas if the data transfer is initiated by the destination, then first source unit will receive strobe signal from the destination. Strobe signal will be made high from low level to high level, and upon recognizing this change, then source unit will be placing the valid data onto the data bus. Okay, this is the difference. Here the data transfer is initiated by the source unit, and here the data transfer is initiated by the destination unit. Okay, this is the strobe controlled data transfer, and this data transfer is having a serious problem. That is, the destination unit is not communicating back to the source unit. Whether the destination unit has received the data or not received the data will not be communicated back to the source unit. This is the biggest drawback of the source strobe controlled data transfer. That's why we are going to look at handshake control data transfer. Okay, again, this handshake control data transfer is also could also be initiated either by source or destination. On the left side you can see source initiated handshake data transfer. On the right side you can see destination initiated data transfer using handshake. Okay, let us look at source initiated. First of all, we need to compare this handshake data transfer with strobe data transfer. If you see, source unit and destination unit is using one data bus and a control signal here, whereas in the handshake there is one more line that is used for acknowledgement. Okay, we had discussed that strobe control unit is having a drawback, that is the destination unit is not acknowledging the source unit. Okay, that is the drawback, and that drawback is eliminated with the help of this third control signal. Okay, which is written as data accepted here, ready for data. Okay, with the help of this, the drawback of non-acknowledgement will be eliminated. Okay, so let us look at the source initiated data transfer. This data transfer can be viewed as communication between two people. Source unit is a person, destination unit is a person. First, source unit wants to send the data to destination unit. So he will place the valid data on the data bus, and then he will make this data valid from low to high, and that will be detected by the destination unit, and he accepts the data from the data bus and he conveys this information by making this data accepted line low to high. Upon checking this change, this source unit will remove the valid data from the data bus and disable this data valid signal. And then this destination unit will disable the data accepted signal. This is how both the source unit and destination unit will communicate. Whereas in this destination initiated data transfer, the data transfer will be initiated by the destination unit. How? It will make the ready for data signal from low to high, and after detecting this change on the ready for data, source unit will place the valid data on the data bus and it will change the status of this data valid from low to high. Okay, after this, the destination unit will receive this valid data on the data bus and then it will disable the ready for data as it has already received the data. As soon as the destination unit disables this ready for data, source unit will also remove the valid data from the data bus and disables the data valid. You can see all these things in this timing signal. Okay, this is how destination initiated data transfer can takes place. Okay, now if you compare this stroke control data transfer and handshake control data transfer, handshake control data transfer is much more reliable. Okay, because of that acknowledgement. Now let us look at the interface that is used for this asynchronous communication. Okay, this is the block diagram and this is the function table of asynchronous communication interface. We had already discussed about interface unit, example of interface unit. So there is a similarity between this interface block diagram and that interface block diagram. Okay, so on the left side it is having bus buffer and timing and control unit, just similar to that one. On the right side you are having transmit register, control register, status register, receiver register. Whereas in the previous example, control and status registers are same, but instead of transmitter register, there you have output data, and instead of receiver register, there was input data. Okay, and along with these registers, some additional registers are also there: shift register and transmitter control and clock, shift register, receiver control and clock. These are the new additions to this interface unit. Okay, let us look at this asynchronous serial transmission format. This is the data transmission format that is used in asynchronous serial communication. In asynchronous serial communication, along with the original data, original character bits, some parity bits will be appended, like start bits, stop bits. Okay, along the start bit, character bit, stop bit, whole this package becomes the data transmission format. This will be transmitted by the CPU through this interface to the input output devices. If the CPU wants to send the data, that means IO write, then it will send the data to this bus buffer, and from there through this transmitter register, it will go through the shift register to the IO device. If the CPU wants to receive the data, then with the help of this IO read, it will receive the data. First the IO device will send the data to this shift register, and that enters into this receiver register, and from the internal bus through the bus buffer, it will reach the CPU. Okay, this is how the CPU will be communicating with the input output device. Now the CPU, if the CPU wants to check the status of the peripheral device, it can check the status register, or it can control the IO device with the help of this control register also. So this is the function table. Okay, in order to use this interface, first it should be selected. So CPU will be selecting this, CPU will be enabling this interface with the help of this chip select unit. If the chip select is 0, it is not working. If it is 1, then only it will do either IO read or IO write, any work. Okay, so this is how the asynchronous data transfer takes place. Thank you.